Today, I'm going to provide an overview of what the marketplace actually is and how we're using it to help our construction clients. I'm also super excited to share that we actually have two current marketplace partners on this call with us today. First being Tony Deacentis, CEO and founder of Ving Compliance Training, and Cliff Mitchell, CEO and founder of ClockShark Timekeeping Solutions. They'll cover some thought leadership on the managing employees in the construction industry. So let's go ahead and get started. And before I cover what the marketplace actually is, let's talk about why. Why did ADP invest in the marketplace? So through independent third-party studies, we found that HR managers like yourself have a 40% increase in the HCM applications that they're being tasked with using for their organization, right? So someone wants to add an ATS system, they go out and purchase it, they come back and they say, hey, make this integrate with Workforce Now. That brings us to lack of integrations. There's 60% lack of integrations with these systems. And then that leads to not enough time for you, right? You're working on tactical tasks as opposed to the progressive items that you really want to be focusing in your HR. So that leads us to the marketplace. What the marketplace is, it's the largest open HCM ecosystem that equips users with a flexible choice and confidence to make their businesses work better. So basically what we did is we worked with other HCM providers out there in the industry, ones that our clients were asking us to partner with. We opened up our technology and we gave them the ability to create an API integration that will work seamlessly in turnkey with Workforce Now or the platform that you're on. So these integrations are ready to go. As soon as you click to purchase, they're ready to be turned on, no pushing and pulling the data. So that gives you the freedom of choice. You're obviously a client of ADP, but you now have freedom if there's a certain application out there that ADP does or does not have solutions around, you can partner with that partner as well. Bi-directional data, there's no need to push and pull data. There's bi-directional APIs that move the data for you. There's no upkeep of two separate databases, three separate databases. It's all done automatically. It's also a digital buying experience. So much like Amazon, we have the marketplace set up where you can go out, you can compare different partners in certain areas, request to do a demo, and then actually purchase from within the marketplace. You can add it to your ADP invoice or you can pay by credit card. Also, an entrepreneur is a platform that developers can craft powerful solutions and tap into a scalable network. So this gives a little bit of an overview of what the marketplace is. With it, you get single sign-on for each of the partners that have gone through the integration process, third-party apps that are available. We also have ADP apps out there as well. It's an e-commerce experience. And lastly, and most importantly, is our security. All of our partners are going to go through the security that ADP goes through on its own to ensure that they have the same criteria in place that we do within ADP. So there are three separate types of applications out there, or apps as we call them, out on the marketplace. You may already be a client of some of the applications out there, like a Concur, another timekeeping solution. In that case, you just need to buy the connector. There's options out there where you can just purchase a connector app and your ADP system will be integrated with that third party. Obviously, third-party solutions or core solutions, this is where you're a client of ADP. You want to purchase a timekeeping system or a learning system. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to evaluate. I'm going to do the purchasing method. And the integration and the actual core services aren't included within that app. And then ADP apps. So maybe during your purchasing process, when you became a new client of ADP, you looked at some modules that maybe weren't a quite fit for you right then and there, but you want to revisit them now. You can always go out to the marketplace and do an e-commerce purchase right through the marketplace. So how do you get to the marketplace? So hopefully this screen looks familiar. You're going to access it right through Workforce Now. We have a little icon at the top, our embeddable, that you would click on. And it's very important that you use this way to get to the marketplace, because once you click on this button, you'll be taken out to the marketplace. And this will show, this will recognize all of your credentials. It'll know who you are, and it'll show you the apps that are relevant to the platform that you are on. So once you get to the marketplace, I'm going to show you kind of some screenshots of what's out there and what we're working on already. But it's very easy to sort. You can sort by partner category is how we have it labeled. So these are the different categories, the compensation modules, the benefits, the timekeeping. So if you know exactly what you're looking for in an area, you can drill down via those categories, or you can sort by industry. So we do have pages set up specifically for specific industries based on feedback from our partners and our clients as to what apps work in best industries. I'm really excited to show you something that's coming soon. This actually is not live yet. We wanted to show this to our ambassador partners first. So what we're doing now is we're doing an entire re-evaluation of the user experience within the marketplace site. And this construction landing page is an example of all of the new landing pages for specific industries that are going to be rolling out later this week. So what we've done is instead of throwing up all the apps that say, yeah, I work with the construction industry and kind of just laying them out there, we actually went to our clients and our partners and we said, you've got to give me some specific items that you're helping our construction clients with. And they came back with items, if you can see, they came back with in the center of the page, you know, we help with recruiting onboarding, we help with compliance, we help with timekeeping solutions. And then when you click on those hot links, it's going to show you the apps that work specifically in those areas. So we're really, really narrowing it down based on feedback from our clients as to what apps specifically you need. We're also going to add a lot of content out there. So what our clients are saying is they want to see success stories. What other clients are using this? What are they saying about the actual apps? And also, white papers, important other information, case studies. So we're really putting the task to our partners, like, what are you doing in this industry? What type of information can you provide our clients? So definitely look for that information. And then also at the bottom, some other features that we're finding that they're helping with our clients in those industries. So that's all I have to say about the marketplace. I could go on, but instead of me going on, I figured it would be great if we could turn this over, like I said, to two of our partners that are actually in the construction industry working with clients every day. The first being Tony Diocentis. And Tony, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks so much. Good afternoon or morning, wherever you are in the United States. My name is Tony Diocentis, CEO and co-founder of a technology company called Ving. And we specialize in developing technology for the construction space, pretty much focusing in on anybody who's building something or part of building something. So the actual GM, the trades, all of the people that are involved in that structure. And the technology really focuses on engaging this audience around their decentralized workforce, around safety, quality, compliance, and then monitoring their engagement with the information throughout the life of the project. So let's talk a little bit about today's subject, though, modernizing your safety training, trends, facts, and how-tos. So we'll go ahead and advance the slide here. To pull the information together, I tapped into some of the colleagues that I work with on a regular basis. Obviously, myself, I just, let's do this, focused a little bit on what we do as a company, but my entire career has really been around creating technologies that engage employees throughout the learning cycle, whether they're in the same place or they're decentralized and out in the field, both asynchronous and synchronously. And then I tap into resources like Dr. Kara Parker, who's an expert in her field on specializing in learning styles and cognitive learning methods. So it's all about how do we structure the technology, the methodology to engage our audiences to get the highest amounts of retention. And then these two construction industry experts in their field. Jennifer Lassiter has worked for decades with construction organizations and interviewed thousands of safety professionals and HR professionals in the construction space. And she's since created a virtual reality, augmented reality company that specializes in engaging throughout the training process using those technologies. And Paul Belair, construction industry CEO for over 15 years, intimately involved in working with residential and commercial construction organizations across the country, as well as a number one best-selling author on Rock the Recession, which focuses in on how the construction industry can survive an impending recession and how to plan ahead for it today. So I've peppered their comments throughout in this discussion that we're having today around how is your training program today? Is it ready for a revamp? And the thing you have to really focus in on is that you're not alone. In the construction industry across the states, we've talked to hundreds of safety professionals, hundreds of HR people, hundreds of project supervisors, and all kinds of safety councils. And what they'll tell you on a regular basis is that they haven't changed things for a long time. It's pretty much status quo out there. Gather around the trailer, send emails out, have people read PDFs, plug in a DVD or a VHS. And these are the challenges that hit their radar screen on a regular basis. So what's important is that we take a step back. And when we think about where we're at with our training program and our particular space within that construction industry, and we've got to think about the people that we're training. And Dr. Parker, who's obviously researched well thought out on this particular subject here, has shared quite a bit with us as we go through and optimize the training environment for our companies through this technology. What she'll say is that you really need to focus in on the three key types of people that are out there. Because if you have just one training style, it's not one training style fits all. Think about your preference. How do you like to learn? Who do you fit into? We have some people who are feelers, some people who are thinkers, and some people are seers. If I'm not in there and I'm actually touching it and working with it, I'm not retaining it. If I don't have fact base to back up why you're teaching me, I'm not retaining, I'm not learning it. So we really have to take a look at our target audience, who's sitting in the seats, who's out there in the field that we're trying to reach, and what type of training style are they? So one of the pro tips is go out and check out this site. It's called 16 Personalities. They've done over 200 million different personality tests. Pick subsets of your teams, have them do the personality, and then extrapolate the results across the rest of your company. It will really help you to identify those key types of learners that you have in your organization. Now, what we've all got to do is we've all got to realize that it's time to mix it up. You have to ensure that you have that well-balanced approach, not only to appeal to the three learning styles, but as well to keep people engaged throughout. We've got to think about the activities that we can put into our learning, mini lectures. So many times I hear about people doing training around a trailer or in a conference room. Speakers are talking for longer than 10 minutes at any given time. It's very hard to hold somebody's attention span when they may not even want to be in the room in the first place. You got to get an opportunity to work together in groups and find an opportunity to get them talking, asking each other's questions. It's all about finding what your method is to increase engagement, retention, and recall. Because when they're out in the field and they're about to do a particular task, if you haven't aligned properly with their learning style, odds are recall isn't going to happen in that particular point in time. And then we all know what happens there. It's lack of quality of work, or somebody gets injured on the job because of a shortcut, or just lack of knowing of what they were supposed to do. So the idea is a pro tip here, your own company checklist. Think in terms of how have I accounted for the different learning styles and the personalities in the room? Do I have a 20-minute span, a 15-minute span, or a 30-minute span of a lecture where I've got the right balance between discussion, hands-on activities, and perhaps some type of group session where they're working on a particular task together and then reporting back to the instructor and those in the room. Make sure that before you do any new training, you look at your checklist and you see if you're adhering to those guidelines that you've put together that map back directly to the key points that we've just covered. And then also stay true to what you've discovered. After each training, it's really important that you sit down and you make note of what worked, and not just by yourself, but obviously ask the people that were in the room. And don't just have them complete a survey. Pull them aside at the logical time, invite them to share what's on top of mind for them, and make sure that you learn from what their feedback is and take it and think about adjusting your style going forward. But a word of caution is, beware of the complainers. Now, there's very few people in our workforces that say, bring on the change, I'll do it, I'll do whatever you want. Typically, in our environment, in the construction industry, we're used to doing so many things the exact way over and over. When something new comes along, we see the eyes roll. And then there's always the naysayers in the group. We still want to listen to them and get their feedback, but we don't want to deviate from all the hard work we've done to date to figure out exactly how to make this program. Instead, listen to what those naysayers and complainers have to say and figure out what's driving that. Maybe you're missed back that you have more hands-on people in the room than you thought you did, and that's what their point of view is coming from. And it's up to us as responsible individuals to make the fine-tuning and adjust our approach going forward. Step two, working with Jennifer Lassiter. She's a fantastic individual that has immersed herself into all different types of training environments and emerged with a sense of compassion around virtual reality and augmented reality. The methodology behind this concept of immersive training is that lectures are just flat out old school. People don't learn that way anymore. They might learn through conversation and sitting in a room for a mini lecture. But think about the way we use the internet for the shortest, quickest path to knowledge, short videos, short documents. And if we see anything that's longer than 3 minutes, we're moving on to the next subject. We didn't even give it a chance to see if it's the right subject. So think in terms of how you move away from a lecture and move into more of a technology-driven environment. And not all technology has to cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. There's all different types of technology out there that you can apply to your environment to get away from that same old, same old. The idea is when you invite somebody to training, you don't want to see them roll their eyes. Oh, another safety training class. Oh, another leadership class. You want them to say, what are we doing this time? They keep mixing it up. They keep introducing new ways of bringing information forward to us. This is going to pay off dividends as it engages individuals throughout the training process. It helps them to practice retaining the information by working with their colleagues in interactive situations, and then clearly demonstrate the ability for recall later in the field when it's most important. One thing to remember is a lecture is not immersive. So even if we're sitting in this conference room and we're doing a particular hands-on activity, you might say, oh, we immersed in the activity and everybody got really engaged with it. Well, that's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is literally putting people in that environment. So if you do some training and you want it to be immersive, the clear-cut manual way is to get out, get in the field, go to the project site, take the instructor there, and do the actual task. Don't just talk about it. Do the actual task in a training way. But the other way to go about doing this is to think about using technology. And two different types of technology are virtual reality and augmented reality. So virtual reality, I'm putting the glasses on, I'm standing in a conference room, but I have the sensation of being fully immersed in that environment, walking around it, climbing, running, touching, sensing different things. Augmented reality is typically where I'm on the job site and I'm looking at a construction site and I'm waving my phone in front of that construction site. And as I do it, the device is automatically recognizing things that it sees in its lens and it's telling me where the danger spots are. Or it's telling me what a piece of equipment is called. And therefore, I can find my way around a project site very quickly. Recently, IOSH did a study, Institution of Occupational Safety and Health, and they put two groups together for virtual reality. And this is very interesting. One group had the typical virtual reality with visual and audio, and the other group had virtual reality with visual audio, plus they had 2 kilowatt heaters pointed at them, and the smell of smoke being piped into the room. And what they found was, even though regular virtual reality was still an immersive experience, that group of people treated their experience more like a game and were often found giggling, laughing, and enjoying the experience. But as soon as they introduced more elements, the heaters, the smell of smoke, this audience reported back that it was more of a sense of urgency and realness to it. The second study that IOSH did was around virtual reality and PowerPoint. And what they found was students in a lecture in a conference room that went through normal lecture training with a PowerPoint and an expert on fire prevention or escape scored very high at the end of that session when they took the test. But with the group that went through virtual reality testing scored lower than the group with PowerPoint, but up to 30 days later had a higher recall of exactly how to remove themselves from a harmful fire situation. So it just goes to show that recall is really what it's all about. We want to make sure that when people are in the field, they can find the information in their heads when they need it. Another thing to think about is the microburst or mini lecture. We have a client in residential construction that uses the mini lecture, this is our technology, Ving, to educate and train customers, trades, and employees. They're training them, a customer, on how to prepare for a walkthrough before they take possession of the house. Or a trade, you're coming to work on our particular project today, here are our safety guidelines. Or an employee getting a message from a CEO about the culture of the safety and training environment. And what they'll tell you is that in all three target audiences, the microburst has engagement rate that shoots through the ceiling, retention rate when people are asked about situations and how they're gonna handle them, of recall shoots through the ceilings, and bar none, outperforming any email PDF document they've ever sent to anybody around the same three, in the same three categories. Step three, talking to Paul Belair. This is an individual who coaches CEOs and owners of construction organizations, whether they're building 50 houses or 5,000 houses, or whether they're building a high rise or whether they're putting the HVAC on top of it. And what Paul will talk to you about is leadership, ownership, throughout the process. And it's really up to us, the people, the folks that are doing the tactical work, to make sure that we have our ducks in a row so that we can get their buy-in. We've got to make sure that we understand what our opportunities are and where we want to go to revamp them. Well, Paul will always talk to me about, and what we talk to our customers about when thinking about an area to revamp in their training, is pick a problem area. Don't necessarily pick the easiest area. Why is that the case? Because easy areas, quite frankly, unfortunately, most people don't care about. They don't have a big return on investment. But if I pick a problem area and I come up with an innovative way of mixing up or revamping my training methodology or introducing a new technology to take it to the next level, people are going to pay attention. I also want to make sure that I'm leveraging any existing areas where the company has already committed investment and I've shown a way that I've taken those dollars and I've excelled and revamped my training or implemented a new technology. In this respect, I'm showing that CEO that I can leverage assets and investments that the company's already committed. And when I go after this problem area, I need the same, and I'm gonna leverage what we've already got in place and be able to come out with a great solution. So when we map those areas together, we tend to find synergies, and then we tend to garner leadership support. Once you've identified that problem area, start small. Don't take on the whole organization. What you want to do is make sure that you have a sample size group of employees that are willing to participate and or a isolated geographic area that you're going to target at first. Once you can prove your results and you've got your method down and refined, now we can start extrapolating that across the state, the country, however far you operate. And without a doubt, make sure you have those benchmarks, timeframes, benchmarks, and milestones. And when you go back to your company leadership with the employee feedback, you're going to have an awesome story to tell. So I want to thank you all very much for the time today. If you ever want to reach out and take a deep dive into any of the research that I have or our technology Ving and then how it can help you revamp your particular training environment, please reach out and talk to us anytime. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Tony. Really great information. We appreciate it. Also, just a reminder, if you want to ask Tony a question, go ahead and submit a question and we'll hit those at the end. Moving on, we're going to turn it over to Cliff Mitchell, CEO and co-founder of ClockShark. Cliff, go ahead.
Hey, good morning. Thanks. Really glad to be on the call with everybody. Exciting to be talking with all of you. So first, a little bit about me, and then I'll tell you what we're talking about. So who I am, I ran a family-owned construction company for about 6 years, then started a software company. Learned a bunch of stuff there, but one important thing that I learned is that construction businesses are just really difficult to run from an operations perspective. So 5 years ago, I struck out and decided, hey, let's start a software company. I want to help construction companies run better and start to kind of optimize some of these operational aspects that were challenging for me as we were running that business. So we started the company ClockShark, and what we do is we're a mobile time tracking app used by construction companies. Okay, so high level, what I want to talk to you all about today is what's going on in software, in construction with software, that is, and how we can think about bringing in cloud solutions to make life in our construction businesses easier. So this is going to be a pretty short presentation today. I'm really only going to be able to skim the surface, but I want to try to cover as much as possible in about 15 minutes and give you all some really good overview and direction to take back into your company, share with others, and kind of just talk to you about how I'm thinking about some of this stuff. And hopefully it resonates for you guys too. So the first question is construction even doing this? Is construction making the move to the cloud? And what do we mean by the cloud? Let's get our terminology straight. So what we mean when we say the cloud is just really getting off of that old software, the stuff that we download and install on our computers and our local network, the type of stuff that's probably been in our business for 20 years and requires us to run our own servers, local network stuff. So we call these legacy on-premise solutions. And so another name for the cloud, software as a service or SaaS, most of us probably know this terminology, but just want to cover it so we're all on the same page. And so by that SaaS, we just mean that all of the software, the data storage, the software updates, that all now becomes our responsibility as a software vendor, and then we help manage all of that on our customers' behalf. Okay, so is this happening? Is construction moving to the cloud? The short answer is yes. But the move is happening somewhat slowly, and you know, we've even got other industries kind of poking fun at us as a slow-moving industry. So that's something I kind of want to talk about today. We're still seeing a lot of companies running these old systems and software. Okay, so having run a good-sized construction company in the past, I think I know what many of you may be facing in your businesses, and that's just a lot of operational complexity, a lot of struggles to operate smoothly, manage all the logistics. And it's frankly more than what's faced in other industries. And I can say that because now we run a software business too. So I believe that construction businesses, especially once they start to reach some decent scale, they're just really, really hard to operate. Things like doing payroll, getting it done on time, getting the job costing right, all of these back office processes to run the business can become a major chore and really painful. And so when I was running our company for a time, I did the payroll myself for part of the company. So I was personally responsible for tracking down timesheets and then doing payroll for about 40 construction workers out in the field. So that was a really painful experience for me. And part of the time, you know, it was because we were doing this part of the time manually with paper timesheets. Part of the time we tried doing it with like these portable time clock systems that synced back to a server in the building. But it was really old school technology, and I don't know whether the paper timesheets or those old school time clocks were better, but let's just say it never really worked all that well, and it was a really painful process for us. So the thinking here is, going forward, how do we think about ways to leverage the new cloud technologies? How do we get that information, that critical information, out in the field and in the office, and how do we get it flowing back and forth in a way that helps the business run better? So, you know, what we don't want to be doing is looking at emails and phone calls and then trying to pull information out and then flow it into our processes, because we probably do a lot of that currently. So when we do this right, when we really get this nailed, it's going to make our processes much easier. So using payroll as an example, when you have a really great payroll processor like ADP, you need a great way also to track time and make it accurate so that you can flow that into payroll. So when employees in the field, let's say they can clock in using a modern time tracking app and then keep track of the project they're working on in real time and then what labor cost code they're working on. Comes in super handy with certified payroll stuff too. When all of that flows right into your payroll with just a few clicks, instead of trying to track down those timesheets I was talking about, that's the sort of automation that I'm talking about that's really magic for your business. So that's kind of what we're talking about here today in the presentation. And that was just one example. Okay, so let's talk about a few more specifics of the cloud and how it can help us in general with some key areas of the business, some aspects of that, okay? So the first thing is mobile and whether or not we're really taking advantage of mobile, okay? This one's kind of obvious, but just hitting on it real quick, every employee now has a computer in their pocket. I'm not talking about a laptop, I'm talking about a smartphone. Smartphones got high-speed data access to the cloud. And the question is, are we really taking advantage of this? Okay, because this wasn't possible 6 or 7 years ago. The second thing is when we do it right, we can put the right information into the right employee's hands at the right time to help run the business smoothly. Okay, so getting the data into the right person's hands at the right time. Third, we can cut down on our IT costs. Okay, this is important too. So with cloud software, you still got to pay for the software. Hey, it's not free, but we can get rid of servers usually. And so a lot of costs and a lot of headaches around IT stuff are usually tied up around servers and local network infrastructure. So, you know, you might be able to reduce the involvement of your IT company or just get rid of them altogether because maybe you've got somebody on staff that can kind of help manage that stuff enough. So definitely some opportunities with the cloud to reduce IT operating costs. Okay, what are a few more ways the cloud can help us? Okay, it can just help us in general with this operational excellence stuff. Okay, it can make collaboration out in the field a lot easier. Okay, getting those project teams out in the field, communicating better around the projects. We all know that this is a really hard thing in a construction business. This communication around projects, it's pretty much a nightmare sometimes, just managing that, making sure everybody's on the same page. Anything we can do to use tech to make that project communication smoother, it's a huge win. So we can cut down on entering data twice, okay? That's a double data entry. We probably do a lot of that in our business right now. So that's something the cloud can help us with also. And then we can just automate a lot of manual workflows. So a lot of those jobs to be done, whether they're getting data from the field to the office, getting that data from the office to the field, or just, you know, back office processes that happen once that data gets back to the office, we can automate a lot of that stuff if we have the right solutions in place. Okay, so what's stopping some construction businesses from doing this? What's stopping some from modernizing with the cloud? What are the common objections? The first big one, and these come from surveys, data security. Okay, this is cited a lot. People think that moving data to the cloud means losing control of it, and that's just not true. Number two, some people think that making this transition is going to be more expensive. It's going to be more expensive than sticking with the old way of doing things. Again, that's not true like we just talked about. Number three, it's easier to keep doing what we have been doing than to change. Nobody likes change. Okay, but Tony talked about that too, right? Again, we have to change even though people don't like it or else we're going to be stuck in the past. Number four, lastly, it can actually be really confusing. This is probably the most important one. It can be confusing how to even go about making this move and getting everything transitioned into modern solutions. There's just a lot of options out there. There's a lot of different systems. There's point solutions. There's platform solutions. And so many different vendors, so many different products. How do we put all this together? How do we get the different products talking to each other? It's very confusing stuff on how we would even go about getting started with doing this. Okay. So what percentage of companies are actually doing this? How are construction companies doing on this migration? We don't have any great statistics from this year, but looking back on a couple of recent surveys, all the way back in 2012, hardly anybody was doing this. 16% of surveyed companies believed the cloud was important to their business. So most people were like, hey, we're just great with our old systems. We're going to keep using them. I don't know about that cloud thing. But by 2017, 85% or more of us in construction were using more than one or more cloud solutions in our business. Now, that doesn't mean they've totally moved to the cloud, but they were using at least some cloud technology in their stack. Okay, so even though we don't have a survey number for 2019, it's probably safe to say this trend's continued. we're probably somewhere into that 90% range now of companies that are using at least some form of cloud technology in the stack. So I'm guessing that most of you on the call have at least got some cloud technology, but maybe you don't have everything moved over. Okay, so let's say we're interested in moving more of our stuff into the cloud, more of our systems. We want to get all of this stuff moved over. How do we go about doing that? What are those considerations? Well, like we just talked about, you don't have to move everything at once. And the good news is that 5 or 6 years ago, there weren't very many good options out there in the cloud for construction software. So that in itself, that lack of solution stopped people. But in 2019, we've really had an explosion and we have a lot more options on the market, which is awesome, but it's also a problem because there's so many choices now that you almost can't figure out how you would go about doing this. It's kind of like information overload as you're looking at products. So one important distinction here as you're trying to make some selections is that there's a couple different approaches. There's construction platforms, and then there's individual app point solutions that solve specific areas of the business. So it sort of comes down to whether you want to go with one of these all-in-one solutions, and I'm talking about products like Procore, CoConstruct, or Red Team, or you can go with sort of a piece-together solution using a combination of different individual point solution type apps. Now, there's pluses and minuses to both of these approaches, and it really depends on what your pain tolerance is around specific aspects of things and what you value most in terms of the best setup to choose. Now, some challenges here to be aware of are that the sheer number of apps for construction make things confusing to navigate. Okay, some advantages with just using a single vendor approach and an all-in-one platform are that you're not going to have to wire things together to get data flowing properly from one app into the next. Now, some of the disadvantages here can be that you're typically talking about solutions that, since they're kind of trying to be everything in the kitchen sink in one product, you may not be getting the best of breed in all of those areas. Okay. So with point solutions, you can often get more robust products that are more capable. They might be able to do more, fit your business a little bit better in specific areas, be more customizable, stuff like that. But you're probably going to have more challenges with getting that data to flow from one part of the technology stack to the next, from one app to the next. Sure, there's integrations. We all know about app integrations. But as I'm sure everyone who's tried wiring up apps in the cloud knows, sometimes the integrations don't do exactly what we want. Sometimes sometimes certain products don't integrate with each other. So it can be difficult to get this working well sometimes and find the right set of vendors that all work well together. Okay, so if we want to go the platform route, what are some of the best platform vendors on the market today for construction? And I also want to clarify to distinguish some of the legacy stuff that I'll bet some of you are still on. I'm not trying to pick on anybody or talk bad on these solutions. Just saying these are what we're talking about when we say legacy platforms. And I'm talking about stuff like Sage 100 Contractor, Sage 300 CRE, Desktop QuickBooks, platforms like that. Okay. Now, what's cutting edge in the cloud? In my opinion, and by the way, I'm not affiliated with any of these companies, but what I think is cutting edge in SaaS platforms for construction is products like Procore, Spectrum by Dexter Cheney, Red Team, CoConstruct, and BuilderTrend. So BuilderTrend and CoConstruct are probably only going to be worth a look if you're a home builder, because those ones are specific to home builder, to being a home builder. But those other three products are your more general construction ERPs. So these are great products to look at if you're looking for an all-in-one solution. What are some point solutions? What are the best point solutions around? I want to give you a few of my favorites. And keep in mind, there's really a lot out there. Again, there's a ton of these, but I really think these are a few that are doing really well, have a lot of customers and traction, and are offering really nice products. So the first one I want to talk about, PlanGrid. These guys started out as a mobile plan viewing app and just issue tracking, so annotation of plans, lightweight communication around plan sets. But it's really expanded into more of a field operations platform that really just facilitates all that communication that I was talking about earlier out in the field to get everybody on the same page around projects. Really nice stuff. Lots of customers recently bought by Autodesk, so they have a lot of resources developing the product. Definitely one to look at. A competitor to PlanGrid FieldWire. Okay, this is another app, very similar in terms of functionality to PlanGrid. We know these guys. We've been in touch with them since they launched about the same time we did. Very competitive with PlanGrid. Also adds mobile messaging to the mix. Okay, and we know that that communication piece in our teams is really important. So FieldWire is definitely one to check out too. The next one I want to talk about is Stack. This is another app that we're in touch with and can vouch for lots of customers. And what they do is they're an estimating package in the cloud. Very comprehensive and nice estimating package in the cloud. It also connects with some other platform products. For example, Stack, if you're using BuilderTrend, will connect directly to BuilderTrend. So you can bring those detailed estimates right into the BuilderTrend platform. The next one I want to talk about is Raken. These guys have done really well. They started out as a daily reporting app, but they've done well. They've added a bunch of customers, and they've also brought on a lightweight timesheets capability recently. Last one, plug for us, ClockShark. We build a mobile timesheets product, and we think we're the best one built for construction. So a few more point solution apps that, you know, I think these are worth checking out too. For cloud storage, and you know, this stuff, Google Drive might be obvious, but I think it's worth mentioning that you can use Google Drive to solve a lot of problems between the office and the field. So sometimes we don't have to look for specialized solutions. If you need something a little bit more enterprise-y, a little bit more customizable, Box and Ignite also make really nice cloud storage products. Data collection. How do we get that information from the field to the office? Google Forms can actually be really, really helpful for this. It's possible. I see a lot of companies build out really nice daily reporting systems just using Google Forms, for example. Messaging and communications, big need out in the construction, out in the field, getting that information back and forth from the office to the field. Slack. Slack is a messaging product, and in software, we all know Slack because we all use it, but I'm always surprised when I talk to construction companies. A lot of construction companies are not aware of Slack. If you need messaging similar to text messaging, but you want it, you know, in a nice app form where you can set up channels around projects and communicate back and forth with the field in an organized way, check out Slack. It's free to get started using. There's another construction-specific one called Field Chat. Newer app, but you might want to check it out also if you want something that's construction-specific and works a little bit differently than Slack. Now, a couple that I want to call out specifically, these work with the ADP Marketplace, which is super cool. Points North is a certified payroll reporting company that works in conjunction with ADP. We know how big a need certified payroll is, probably around some or all of your businesses. If you're doing that, you know, those high-dollar federal contracts. So check out Points North. They automate that process of certified payroll reporting, works in conjunction with ADP. Also, Bolt, which is a construction management platform that works in conjunction with ADP. So that's about it for the presentation today. It was really awesome talking with all of you. And if you'd like to get in touch with me, you can email me, call me. You can also come by our website. If you're interested in our app, go to the ADP Marketplace and check it out there. But again, it's been really awesome talking with all of you. I hope that this kind of gave you some ideas on ways to think about cloud technology in your business that maybe you weren't thinking of. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me anytime. Always be glad to talk with you. So that's about it. I want to turn it back over to the ADP folks.
Great. Thanks, Cliff. Really good information. And I will open it up to the floor with any questions. Go ahead and submit your questions, and we'll go ahead and catch those and read those. We've got a couple minutes here. Okay, the first question we have is for Tony with Ving. Tony, every trainee manager has issues with getting their employees to actually complete trainings and be engaged with the program in a timely manner. Sometimes construction is a little bit harder with their employees being remote. What does Ving do to help their clients incent their employees to complete their trainings?
Sure. Great question. So Ving makes it really easy for a employee out in the field, I always like to say the folks with the mud on their boots, to engage with training. And there are little microbursts of information. And as they interact with that video, maybe it's a 3-minute video long, and they've got a 2-page checklist they need to look at, and maybe a couple of items that they need to answer questions on, Ving's tracking their level of engagement with every single piece of that information in that microburst that they touch to make sure that they got it, read it, watched it, engaged with it, and understood it. And on the dashboard side, the safety manager or the accountable supervisor can see in real time or through alerts how engaged people are with the information. And they can actually go ahead and create little contests out of it for quickest engaged or most thoroughly engaged, or a project team of people that all completed the materials on time, all different kinds of things that people do. And it really helps not only because of the format that the technology delivers the information in, but because there's a little bit of a competitive edge to it. People end up talking about when they completed it. And it really creates a lot of attention, you will, around critical on-the-job information.
Great. Awesome. Okay. The next question is for Cliff with ClockShark. Okay, ClockShark functionality-specific question. Is there a way to track where my workers are throughout the day so I can see who can pull up a job for another job that's close by?
Yeah, definitely you can do that. So, I mean, one of the most important kind of differentiators on ClockShark's time tracking system versus, you know, some other stuff that's out there for time and attendance, because we're built specifically for the field and for construction companies, we've focused heavily on that location side of things, that GPS tracking side of things. So as employees work throughout the day, as they clock in and out, as they switch from one job to another, you're going to see their position more or less live in your ClockShark dashboard and on the ClockShark mobile app. That comes in handy just for kind of knowing where people are at, or for this, you know, to answer the specific question on, hey, if I want to send somebody to another job, let's say, you know, I get a call from a different job site and we need some more folks over there because something's not going well, or something came up, we need to move some staff around. So knowing where people are at in real time is definitely something that you can do. There's a screen in ClockShark that's called Who's Working Now, and then available on the web, also available on the mobile app, and updated more or less in real time. So several times per hour, we update the location of employees. We don't do it every minute, because what we found is if we do those location updates every minute or every 30 seconds, for example, it drains battery on that device. And the last thing we want is employees that are complaining, hey, you've got this work-related app that you're asking me to run on my mobile device, or maybe you have your fleet of your own company devices. But so long story short, we've found that using a sampling frequency of several times per hour for locations works out really well. It gives you good visibility into where people are at, doesn't drain the battery on the devices, and, you know, allows you to make those operational decisions in real time, make sure people are where you think they are, and all of that good stuff.
Great, thanks. Next question is for Tony with Ving. I see that you're focused a lot on the flow and revamping of training programs, but I'm curious to know how you suggest dealing with the actual people that do the training. They may know a lot about the field, but they may not necessarily have training experience.
Yeah, that is a great question. So one of the things that any CEO or safety director or quality assurance director wants to know is that the message that I'm sending out to the field around these key areas of your job are being received. So that's number one. And I need to have that close feedback loop through technology to help enable that. The second thing they want to know is consistency of message. Because I might have multiple supervisors involved in a particular project, or I might have multiple project sites, but they're all getting the same message. The big challenge is, how do I enable somebody who's great at their job, but not necessarily great at reading a memo or an email that says, here's 4 things you need to train your folks on, and then go get them and train them on it. And being consistent between each of them making sure it's kind of like the old telephone line game, right? As the further it gets down the line, the more liberty that people take with the instruction and the consistency of the message really starts to lose. So what we see a lot of people doing is with tablets in the field, they'll have one key video message or one key thing that they all gather around and watch on a tablet, and then that supervisor will lead a discussion around it. And typically, like for example, in Ving, you can actually even select the people that are standing around you so they get credit for going through the training. But everybody watched one individual deliver one key message, and then the discussion helped people get more involved in it.
Great. Thanks, Tony. Okay, we've got time for one more. It looks like this is for ClockShark and Cliff. Product specific with capabilities. Is there a solution for tracking time by job? We know how many hours they work, but looking to get the details into which projects they're working on.
Absolutely. Because, job costing, this is like one of the most important things for us in construction in terms of the payroll aspects and also project management aspects of understanding where is our labor going, what job is it going into, and then within which job, within each job that is, what labor cost codes is that going into. Becomes even more critical when we're dealing with certified payroll situations. So the short answer is absolutely. The whole premise of ClockShark is that it's built for that location tracking that we talked about earlier, but also for job costing. So as employees are clocking in and out, whether that's they're clocking in and out from the field or you got folks back in the office, they're able to select in real time what project they're working on and then also what labor cost code they're working on. So that selection of that stuff is designed to be super simple, could also be driven by schedules. So for example, if you set up a schedule for your employees, you don't have to use scheduling. A lot of people use the time tracking in ClockShark without using scheduling. But if you want to use scheduling alongside our time tracking, you can set up a schedule with the job and then the labor cost code even that an employee's plan to be working on that day. They can clock directly into that automatically from that schedule and have those fields pre-populated on the timesheet based on the schedule. Or if you're not using scheduling, it's as simple as they just select that from a drop list as they're clocking in. You can also limit what specific employees are seeing. So let's say you've got a group of employees and one group of employees or a department team only works on specific jobs. We can limit which jobs and cost codes are displayed to them. We can also limit which jobs and cost codes, we can also limit like on a certified payroll job, for example, which cost codes are displayed for a specific job. So if we want to set up a job, it's certified payroll and load in all of the specific certified payroll cost codes per the wage decision, we can easily do that. And now the cool part is when that gets back into the system and all of this happens in real time, you can, you know, watch all of this stuff unfold on a daily basis, even an hourly basis, really, to see where you're at, how you're tracking on these projects. Look at reporting, send reports to other people in the company. So if you're a payroll HR person, whatever your role is, if you're in the back office, you can easily flow that information around with PDF reports or spreadsheets out of the system, or just give other people, other managers, other folks in the business access to the system, either via mobile app or via the website to see all that same job costing stuff in real time. So definitely strong on job costing.
Perfect. Great answer. So that is it for the questions. On behalf of the Marketplace team, thank you all for joining.